The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. I am a parcel of vain striving, by a mere chance held together. Sometimes, perhaps in the silence of the night, when there is a moment for quiet reflection, pause to ask, what is this burning package of desire known as the body? What is this seething mass of chaotic thought known as the mind? Think about it. Some of the answers you get will frighten, amuse, and astound you.
Somebody knew Jerry was going to be at that corner.
Okay.
Somebody set him up.
Yeah. That's what must have happened.
Then, Lieutenant, what we have to find out is who. Who knew Jerry would be there?
Well, Jerry knew.
And the killer knew.
And listen, Inspector... I knew.
Our mystery drama, The Smoking Pistol, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Howard Da Silva. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Quis custodiat ipsos? Asked the ancient Roman poet Juvenal. But who is to guard the guards themselves? Those who watch over us, those to whom we entrust the right to use the awful power of the state in our name. As you can see, it's not a new problem. For the guards themselves are also human, which means they are neither better nor worse than the best or the worst of us. This has been a bad day for Detective Lieutenant Harry Reinfeld, quite possibly the worst day he has ever known in his life.
Harry, I don't know what to tell you. I'm so sorry.
I saw him, Jim. I just saw him.
I got hot coffee here.
He was laying there.
Let me pour you a cup.
Huh? He didn't even look dead. What's he doing in the morgue, I said.
Here, drink this, Harry. Drink it.
What's this 21-year-old kid doing, laying on a slab in the morgue? He don't even look dead.
You want to go home, Harry?
But then you look close and there it is.
Maybe you should come home with me, Harry.
Just a little black hole.
Stay with Belle and me tonight, Harry, and get some sleep.
And it's my fault.
No, it isn't.
He was crazy to be a cop. Why do you want to be a cop, I asked him. Go to college, I told him.
He went to college.
Yeah. The day he graduated, he joined the cops. What did he need it for? I gave the department 25 years. Shouldn't that be enough for one family? He could have made something out of himself.
He made something out of himself.
Yeah. Well, here's how it is right now. I'm out to get the punk that killed my boy.
I know how you feel.
If I have to spend the rest of my life, I'll get him. And, Jim, this is between you and me. Don't expect me to bring him in.
Harry.
So look at me, Jim. Harry Reinfeld, Detective Lieutenant Harry Reinfeld, ace homicide sleuth. That's what it says in the papers.
There's something you...
All those cases I solved, we used to sit around and laugh at the stories they wrote about me, remember? We know what police work is, don't we, Jim? Huh? Don't we?
Sure, Harry.
All those cases I solved for the city, for the law, for the taxpayers, for the department. Well, now I'm going to solve one for me. I'm going to crack one, break it wide open. Nothing, nobody's going to stop me. And when I get my hands on that...
Harry, sit down.
Don't you give me orders.
I'm your superior. I got the right to give you orders.
Not today.
Sit down. We got him.
You what?
I said, we got him.
You brought him in?
Yeah.
Who have you got?
Well, he was there on the corner of Collins and Maple, a gun in one hand, Jerry's wallet in the other, some glassine packets of horse scattered on the ground.
Go ahead.
Well, what more do you need? What more does the DA have to produce for first degree? It was a drug bust, and the punk had a gun, and...
Yeah? Yeah, what's the punk's name?
Mason. George Mason.
Has he got a sheet?
Oh, some little stuff. Break and entry, assault.
Where is he?
Down in the holding pen.
I want to look at him.
Harry, would that be such a good idea?
I want to see the punk that killed my son.
Maybe you shouldn't, Harry. Not now. Not the way you feel now.
I said I'm going down to the tank. On your feet, punk. What's your name? You have a name, don't you? Okay, that doesn't matter. So, you confessed yet? Let's hear the answer, punk. Has he confessed, Jim?
He won't say a word.
He won't say a word, huh? Quiet little punk, right? So, let's go over what happened again. There's this young undercover cop, and he arranges to make a buy from you, right, punk? On the corner of Collins and Maple, you meet. You hand over the junk, he flashes the badge, and you pull a gun, right? Right, punk? What's the matter? Now answer me.
He doesn't have to talk, Harry.
And you pull the trigger. You kill the cop. That's what happened, right?
Harry, you know the law better than anyone else around here. He doesn't have to say a word.
Oh, yes, he does. He does, and I'm going to make him sing the loudest song you ever heard.
Are you crazy? You can't rough this kid up.
He's going to talk, Jim.
Lay a finger on him, and you destroy the case. He'll get away with it. The judge will have to throw it out of court.
He's never going to get to court.
Harry, you're crazy.
No, Jim, he killed my son.
Put that gun back in the holster.
Don't try to make me, Jim.
You're a police officer.
I'm also a father. That is, I was a father.
You took an oath to uphold the law.
There's another law, an older law. An eye for an eye. Now, punk, you're gonna die.
Harry!
Confess, punk. Don't go to meet your maker with a lie in your soul. Don't go with a sin in your heart. Confess now. Confess to me, and I'll forgive you. And I'll send you out of the world clean.
You're crazy, Harry.
Come on, punk. Confess before I pull the trigger.
Jump him, Carter!
What?
Hold it, Carter! Hold on to him!
I'll kill him, and I'm gonna...
Hold on to that gun hand, Carter! Now, hold on!
You can't stop me!
You asked for it, Harry! I'm sorry, Harry. I'm sorry. Here, Harry, drink this.
What happened?
Well, we had to subdue you, as the saying goes.
Subdue? Yeah. I've been on the other side of that subdue from time to time, you know.
Yeah, well, now you know how the other half lives.
I see. I'm home.
Yeah. Carter and I figured it would be best to bring you here. You would have killed that punk.
I would have.
Well, can I give you back your gun?
Yeah.
Harry, take some time off. You got plenty coming due. Think about it, huh?
I'll think about it.
You want to come over to the house and stay with Belle and me for a while?
No, Jim, I'll stay here.
You shouldn't be alone.
I know. But I'm going to be alone for the rest of my life. All right, I hear you. Yes?
You're Lieutenant Reinfield.
Yes?
May I come in?
Well,
It's very important.
Important? I'm sorry, ma'am. I can't consider anything as being important today. I just buried my son.
I know. I was at the funeral.
Well, then I'm sure you know how I feel.
Not now, but I will. Because a few months from now, I'll be coming home from my son's funeral.
I beg your pardon?
My son is going to die. Everybody says so. That's because everybody says he killed a cop.
Look, ma'am,
My name is Mason. Bessie Mason.
Mason?
I'm George Mason's mother. I must talk to you.
We don't have anything to say to each other.
Please.
Mrs. Mason.
Please.
Look, I don't want to seem impolite or anything like that, but I must ask you to leave.
But he didn't do it.
The evidence speaks for itself.
I don't care about your evidence.
Well, what do you want me to do?
What the city pays you to do. Find the killer.
The killer's been found.
My son is innocent.
How do you know?
Because he told me.
Oh, sure, yeah. That makes everything different. Your son is a punk.
In many ways, yes. I can't deny that.
He's already done time?
That's a matter of record.
Once for break and entry?
Yes.
And once for assault?
Yes.
And he was innocent those times, too, huh?
No.
So he's not a little angel?
No, he's far from it. But he's not a murderer.
Look, lady, I just can't stand here and talk to you. You'll have to excuse
please,
me.
Please let me in.
I...
Thank you.
What do you want me to do?
I've already told you. Find the killer. Now, Lieutenant, you had a good boy. I don't. And it's my fault. I was busy, very busy. His father ran out on me many years ago, and I got a job in personnel. I made something of myself. But I guess I neglected George.
Mrs. Mason, please believe me. I can't do anything
it's
for you.
It's funny how we could always find the wrong kind of friends. But, you know, no matter what kind of trouble he got into, one thing he never did, he never lied to me. And he said to me, Mother, I didn't kill that cop. I didn't.
Look, Mrs. Mason, let me tell you something. I've had experience in these things. He has to hold on to you. You're all he's got. And so he has to deny it.
But I believe him.
And by denying it to you, he denies it to himself because he doesn't want to believe he committed murder.
I believe him.
Yeah.
Why don't you believe him?
Why should I believe him?
Because you're the best detective on the force.
Okay. Look, Mrs. Mason, I can understand how you feel, but what you're asking me to do is...
What am I asking you to do? The thing you do best. I read the papers.
Don't believe what you read.
Oh, it isn't true. What they say, that Harry Reinfeld is an intuitive detective, that he has a feel for how a case should be...
Oh, that's just newspaper talk. Mrs. Mason, on the basis of information and evidence assembled by the police department, the district attorney has asked for an indictment. It's over.
Have you been fair to me, Lieutenant?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I think you do. Have you been fair to my son? Of course, he's only a young punk in your eyes, but he is entitled to justice.
He'll get it in court.
But he isn't getting it from you. Now, do one thing, Lieutenant. Please. Assume that it wasn't your son who died. Suppose it was just another homicide victim, and you were the investigating officer. Now, would you be satisfied?
Mrs. Mason, I have to ask you to leave.
All right. All right, I'll go. But I've asked the question, and you have to answer it.
I don't have to answer to you.
That's true, you don't. But you do have to answer to yourself.
He had the gun in his hand.
He doesn't deny it.
He had my son's wallet.
He doesn't deny that either.
Well, what's everybody supposed to think, then?
I don't know what everybody's supposed to think. I want to know what Lieutenant Harry Reinfeld thinks. What ideas are in his head? What does he see? I know my son is innocent. Won't you prove it, Lieutenant?
In a recent, highly celebrated public proceeding, a definition of guilt was requested. And it was said that if a murder has been committed, and you see a man near the corpse with a smoking pistol in his hand, it would be reasonable to assume he's the killer. The smoking pistol. That does it. Or or does it? I'll continue in just a few moments. The victim, a young undercover cop named Jerry Reinfield. The suspect, with the smoking pistol in his hand, young George Mason. The detective, the victim's father, Lieutenant Harry Reinfield. The case is open and shut. That is, it should be. But the suspect's mother, Bessie Mason, believes her son is innocent. Well, faith can move mountains, or so we've been told.
Mrs. Mason, I must ask you to leave.
All right. I'll go. Because I know the kind of man you are, Lieutenant. You swore you wouldn't rest until you found your son's murderer.
He's been found.
Are you sure? Are you sure?
What are your plans, Leona?
Plans? I don't know. I haven't made any.
Are you going to?
I suppose so. One day. Thanks for taking me to dinner, Dad.
Thanks for calling me Dad.
I guess today it would have been official.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Leona.
A quiet little wedding. That's what we wanted.
You'd have made a good wife for a cop.
Oh, how do you know? You've known me such a short time. Whirlwind courtship, that was Jerry.
Love at first sight. It's the only kind there is.
Jerry. He met me at a party on a Friday night. He proposed to me on Saturday morning. I said yes Saturday afternoon. Saturday night, he tried to talk me out of it.
Why?
He suddenly realized, he said, how dangerous a cop's life can be. He didn't want me to be a cop's wife. Especially his wife. Doing undercover work, he'd made a lot of enemies.
Yeah, I know.
After some pretty good arrests, there were threats made on his life.
Yeah, we all get those.
He tried to talk me out of it, but by then it was too late. I was in love with him, too.
I know how you feel, Leona. But you're only 22. Life has to go on.
I suppose it does. Although I wonder why.
You think so now, but time will pass. You'll find another guy.
I know. That's why it's so awful. That night, he was supposed to come over for dinner. And he said, I'm going to be late. I have to meet a fellow all the way across town, corner of Collins and Maple.
Collins and Maple.
And I said to him, Jerry, this is confidential. How can you tell me? And he gave me that smile of his and said, you mean I can't trust you, honey?
I used to tell his mother everything, too. You're not supposed to, you know.
I was so scared. It's such a dreadful neighborhood. And he laughed and said, if you're out to make a drug bust, you don't usually go to the high rent district. One consolation. At least they got the killer.
Yeah, we got the killer. The latest manpower allotment. Allotment? Is that one L or two?
Two L's.
Huh? What are you doing here?
My son goes on trial tomorrow.
Look, Mrs. Mason.
I tried to get you at home, but you're never there.
Mrs. Mason, I've already told you. There's nothing I can
do. I know what you told me. I've come here to ask you a few questions.
I'm busy, and besides, there's no
questions
use
questions you should have asked yourself. Now, who was your son supposed to meet?
We know that. A drug pusher.
Right. Not anyone of great importance, just a pusher.
Your son.
Let's say it was my son. Why would my son kill him?
Because, A, your son spotted him as a cop. Or B, after my son identified himself, your son decided to shoot it out.
You're forgetting C. Your son's gun was still in his holster. Your son felt safe. Why? Because he knew he was going to pick up a small potato.
That describes your son, doesn't it?
But small potatoes don't kill cops. Why? You know perfectly well, if my son was pushing drugs, he'd be part of an organization. You know they protect their own. You know that he would get a suspended sentence, maybe a few months in jail. That's how it usually works out. Why kill?
Reasonable, logical. But your son just lost his head.
My son didn't do it. And your son wasn't there merely to catch a small-time pusher. He was being set up.
By who?
Well, am I a law officer? Do I have the resources of the police department behind me?
Why would my son be set up?
Well, maybe he was too good a cop. Maybe somebody didn't like him.
If your son didn't do it, why was he there with a gun in his hand?
Why don't you ask him?
The other officers in the case have asked him.
Then why didn't they listen to his answer? Really listen.
Mrs. Mason.
You know I'm right.
What do you want from me?
Now, why are you angry? I'm just a mother and not a very good one. Now, all I know is my son tells me he's innocent. And I want to believe it. I want to believe it.
Now, look.
It's all right. I'm sorry I bothered you. Please excuse me.
Okay, Pete. I'll bang on the door when I want to see you.
No, God. Don't leave him in the cell with me. He'll kill me.
Ah, shut up. See you later, Pete.
Don't go. He'll kill me.
I said shut up.
What do you want?
The truth, punk.
I got a name. It's George. George Mason.
To me, you're still a punk.
You can't kill me.
I'm not gonna kill you.
What do you want from me? What are you doing here?
Your mother wanted me to talk to you.
My mother? You mean my old lady asked you to come here?
I'm doing this for her sake.
Yeah. Yeah, Bessie's still a good-looking dame, ain't she?
I'm going to let that pass, but don't press your luck.
So, yeah, she's cut up about me. Well, it's the only time.
What do you mean it's the only time?
She never knows I'm alive, except when I'm in jail.
Is that so?
Yeah. She's a very busy dame, you know. Works at a big, important job. Runs with big, important guys.
Look, I'm not here to talk about her. I want to talk about you.
She always gets guys to do things for her. I don't care what it is, you know, even something like this. Well, look, you're here.
What happened that night?
You wouldn't believe a word.
Well, tell it to me, then.
I already told it 100 times.
Make it 101. Let's start with what we've got. You were on Collins and Maple, huh?
Yeah, you know, Collins and Maple. It's a place for all kinds of, you know, weird characters.
And you were looking for some loose change, yeah?
I'm coming down Maple, and just as I get to Collins, I hear voices.
Voices? Saying what?
I don't know, just voices. I can't make out the words. Anyhow, I hear a shot, and I hear steps running off, and I hear somebody moaning, so I go around the corner, and it's dark. I see someone laying on the ground. I bend down. He's dead.
How did you know he was dead?
You can tell when somebody's dead. So I figure, why does he need his wallet? Where he's going, he don't need nothing. So I reach inside his jacket, and there it is. So now I hear footsteps coming around Maple, see? And I get scared. There's this pistol laying on the ground. So like a chump, I pick it up. Maybe I need it, you know? And the next thing I know, there are these two guys pointing guns at me. And they yell, freeze! Police officers! And that's a story.
Yeah. Some story.
I told you you wouldn't believe it.
Go back to the voices now.
I'm not even sure they were voices.
But what were they then?
Well, you're walking down the street, mind your own business. You hear like a hum of, you know, maybe people talking. Who pays attention? And then bang, the shot.
You say you heard footsteps running off. Did you see anybody?
Well, by the time I turned the corner, whoever it was got away.
What did the footsteps sound like?
For crying out loud, what do footsteps sound like?
Were they heavy footsteps?
Well,
did it sound like it was a big guy?
Heavy step? Oh, I see what you mean. No, they wasn't heavy. They were light.
Light?
Yeah. You could almost picture a guy to, you know, by the sound of the footsteps. Yeah, I see what you mean, yeah.
Okay, get over it. How do you picture this guy?
Well, no, wait a second. Wait a second. I don't picture him as a guy at all. It was a dame.
A dame?
Yeah, but listen, when a dame is running down a sidewalk, a dame with heels, you know, it makes a sound like rap, tap, tap, click, 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 you know?
A dame, huh?
Yeah.
Why didn't you say this before?
Nobody ever asked me before. Who believed me? You? Do you believe me? Or are you just trying to score some points with the old lady?
I think it's time I got out of here.
Harry, we were all through this. We went over it with his partners, Carter and Fordyce. He said to them, I'm making a contact at Collins and Maple, 9:00. They were there to back him up. They had to keep out of sight. They saw him go around the corner, then they heard the shot. When they got to him, he was on the ground. And the punk, this George Mason, was standing there with the gun in his hand.
And they didn't see anybody else? Didn't hear anybody else?
You want to ask him again, he'll get the same answer.
The punk says he heard someone running away.
Oh, sure. What's the matter with you, Harry? It's your way of reacting to your son's death. Suddenly this concern for the killer.
Who says he's the killer?
Harry, you're talking to me. He was standing there with the smoking pistol. Now, we're satisfied he did it. So is the DA. In a matter of weeks, so will 9 judges and a jury.
Yeah, well, maybe I'm not satisfied.
It can be a problem if your attitude becomes known, Harry. Well, once he's acquitted, that's the ballgame.
I'm not sure of anything anymore.
Ever since Ruth died, your son has been your whole life. I know that. And now, suddenly he's gone, and you've got nothing and nobody.
Well, that has nothing to do with it.
This Mrs. Mason is a very good-looking woman.
And that has nothing to do with it.
You sure about that? You're lonely, Harry.
She means nothing at all to me. Nothing. I got a hunch about this case.
Harry, the two of them, the punk and his mother, they could be working this together, playing you for a sucker.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, you admit it's possible.
Oh, anything's possible. Everything's possible.
All right. What are you going to do?
I'm going to nail it down.
How?
I don't know yet. I've got a hunch. And as far as it goes, it's crazy. But I'm going to run it down. All the way down.
As it stands right now, the district attorney has a good enough case to get a verdict of murder in the first degree against George Mason for the murder of Officer Jerry Reinfield. He had the smoking pistol in his hand. Why shouldn't Lieutenant Harry Reinfield be satisfied with that and let the law take its course? Why? I'm sure we'll find out in Act 3. According to Lieutenant Harry Reinfield, is a place of feelings and hunches. Yes, people do pay lip service to something known as facts, but there's nothing factual about the truly important things in our lives. Do we consider facts when we love? Do we look for facts when we hate? Do we require facts to support what we believe? And what is a fact, anyhow? Do any two people look at the same so-called fact in exactly the same way?
You, busy, Harry?
Yeah.
Doing what?
I'm looking through this file.
Which file is that?
The threat file.
What for?
These are all the letters we get threatening to kill cops.
Harry, this is stuff written by nuts.
Who else commits murder?
Harry, this thing is so obvious. George Mason has to be the killer. What are you doing to yourself?
This is how I work.
Is this the theory we're going on now? Some nut sends a letter threatening to kill a cop? Then he sets Jerry up?
We're just following a certain line of inquiry and seeing where it leads us.
Oh, yeah. Well, let me know when you get there.
Hey, look at this. A plain piece of white paper, neat, clean, and typed. Very good typing, huh? Fresh black ribbon.
So what?
Your average nut letter is typed badly on an old machine with hardly any black at all on the ribbon.
You still haven't told me what this proves.
The strike on each letter is even. And this was done by a typist.
Okay, there are nuts who know how to type, so what?
But listen to this. I intend to get even with you for what you did to someone I love more than anyone else in the world. What was done to him will be done to you.
And?
That's it. That's all of it.
And somebody wrote that kind of note to Jerry?
No. It's addressed to me.
To you?
See? Lieutenant Harry Reinfield.
For the sake of argument, somebody's out to get you. So they call to set up a trap. But the call goes to the wrong Reinfield. To your son Jerry instead. So it's mistaken identity.
If I could only find the machine on which this was typed.
Oh, sure. There are only a million typewriters in the city.
Look, Lieutenant, I told you. I couldn't make out what them voices were saying.
Now, just relax. You're not giving me any help. The voices now. They were low?
I could hardly hear them.
Well, what did you hear? Now, just be quiet. Don't say a word. You're walking down the street at night. It's dark. Deserted. You approach the corner. You're aware of voices.
I told you, I...
Be quiet. Why do you say you heard voices?
Because...
Come on, tell me.
Because...
Why do you say voices? Why not noise from a truck, or why not a dog barking?
Because they were human voices. I mean, people. They were saying words.
What words?
I don't remember. There's no way I can remember.
Don't quit on me now.
I wasn't paying attention.
Well, maybe you don't remember the words. Can you remember how they were said?
How they were said?
Yeah, did it sound angry, like an argument?
An argument? Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
Why?
It sounded like a fight. One word I can remember. One word. Crazy.
Crazy?
Yeah, that was the word. No, the two words. You're crazy. And then the shot. And the dame ran away. I mean, I heard what had to be a dame's footsteps running away.
You heard him say, "You're crazy," right?
Yeah. Now that I concentrate, that's what I heard. But don't ask me to remember anything else. That was all I heard.
It's enough. The question is, what did I ever do to anybody that would make some dame want to kill me?
Harry, where are you getting all this from?
The note. The note was written by a woman.
How do you know?
We agree it was done by a professional typist, huh?
Well, there are plenty of men who are professional typists.
Yeah, but George Mason says he heard a woman's footsteps.
If I were in the spot George Mason's in, I'd say anything.
Oh, work with me on this, will you? What did I ever do to anyone that would make some dame want to kill me? Now, this note was received on April the 18th, which means that whatever it was, it happened before that date. Now, what did I do?
It beats me.
You were the one who said it could have been mistaken identity. Someone's out to get me. They call me to set me up, except they get Jerry by mistake. So this dame meets Jerry and says, "Lieutenant Reinfield, I'm going to kill you," or something like that. And she has the gun, and Jerry says, "You're crazy." And that's what George Mason heard. The question is, whose husband or whose boyfriend did I kill?
You didn't kill anybody, Harry.
Yeah, I know that. In all the years on the force, I never had to fire a single shot. But whose husband or boyfriend did I send up for life, or who died on account of me?
You better forget that letter and the file and let justice take its course.
Lieutenant.
Oh? Oh. Hello, Mrs. Mason.
I've just come from the courtroom. The jury will find him guilty.
Mrs. Mason, I've done what I could.
Have you?
What more do you want?
I don't want my son to pay for a crime he didn't commit.
I'm going to tell you something, Mrs. Mason. You can take this any way you like. I didn't have to do anything at all. It wasn't my case, you understand? You talked me into trying to open up something that was already closed as far as the department is concerned.
I thought you were proceeding out of a sense of duty.
Oh, that's just conversation. Look, I went as far as I could, and it wasn't easy. What I'm doing could be prejudicing the state's case against your son.
Well, our lawyer doesn't seem to be getting much mileage out of that.
I don't know why I'm doing this. Am I doing this because you're an attractive woman?
We're very much alike in certain ways. We go by intuition. I follow mine all the way. And usually, you go all the way with yours. Except this time.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Now, don't fence with me. Are you protecting somebody?
Who?
You tell me. Now, there's one last question. What would you do as a matter of routine in an ordinary case that you haven't done here?
Nothing. I've done absolutely everything.
Yes? What?
Well, but it's not important here.
What's not important?
Well, going on the theory that your son is innocent, who knew my son would be on that street corner?
Well?
Nobody.
Nobody?
Well, his two partners, I eliminate them.
And nobody else?
There was nobody else.
Yes?
There was somebody else.
Who?
Oh, that's impossible. That's impossible.
Is it impossible, or do you want it to be impossible?
Mrs. Mason, I need your help. Here, read this note.
I intend to get even with you for what you did to someone I love more than anyone else in this world. What was done to him will be done to you.
Now, why do I believe that Jerry was killed by mistake? Maybe that was how the killer wanted to get back at me.
Who's the killer?
The one who typed this note. Now, if the person who knew where Jerry was going to be that night also had the machine on which this was typed, I've broken the case. Are you still willing to help?
Yes? I'm sorry to ring your bell this late. I just moved into the building. Do you have a typewriter?
Yes, why?
I see your name is Lewis.
Leona Lewis.
Miss Lewis. My name is Smith, Mrs. Smith. I have to fill in this lease form and drop it off at the landlord's office first thing in the morning. And my typewriter broke down. I know it's an imposition.
Oh, it's all right. Come on in.
See, I have an electric, and when something goes wrong...
Well, there it is on the table. You don't have to take it out of the case.
Oh, thank you. Oh, I see you're packed. Are you moving?
Yes. Going back home.
Home?
The Midwest. There's nothing here for me anymore.
Oh, this is a very good machine.
I keep it that way. Learned it from my father. He was a first-class machinist.
Was?
Yes. He died.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Was he ill?
He had a sickness there's no cure for. Have we met before?
I don't think so.
You look familiar.
What was the sickness?
A broken heart. You see, my brother had been sent to prison.
Oh, that's awful.
And my brother died there in an accident.
Oh.
I wish I knew why you look so familiar. I've seen you somewhere recently.
Oh, Phil!
finished. Thank you very much, Miss Lewis.
When my brother died, it killed my father. The grief was too much to bear.
Well, I understand, but those things can't be helped.
Oh, don't say that. I was able to help it.
Really?
Yes, very much. Wait. Now I know where I've seen you before. Your name isn't Smith. It's Mason. Your picture is in tonight's paper. Your son is on trial for the murder of that cop.
Don't say that, cop. He was your fiancé.
So that's why you wanted a sample from my typewriter.
Yes, and I've got it.
Well, you won't keep it.
I don't see how you can take it from me.
I can. Just don't make me use this.
Now, shooting won't help you.
Oh, it'll help me?
No, you can't kill me.
I won't have to. You see, first, you will place that paper you typed on the table.
That's it.
And now, you will walk into that closet.
It's not going to help. We know that you killed Jerry Reinfield.
Who knows? You? What can you prove? I'll destroy the paper. I'll lose the typewriter where no one can ever find it. And it all comes down to your word against mine.
Why? Why did you kill him?
The idea was to kill him so his father would know how it was with my father.
But he must have been a nice boy.
Yes. That's why I had to kill him quickly. I was starting to fall in love with him. Okay. Now get into that closet.
Oh.
Open the door. Inside.
Oh.
Now, to get out of here, get rid of the gun and the typewriter.
Hello, Leona.
Hello, Leona, says Lieutenant Harry Reinfield. Of course, goodbye, Leona, might be more appropriate. I can inform you that Leona Lewis was found mentally disturbed and is serving an indeterminate sentence. I shall return shortly. Now, you talk about facts, and yet wasn't it Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes himself who said, "The decision will depend on a judgment or intuition more subtle than any articulate major premise." Yes, it was. And so what you should do is follow your own subtle intuition and attend us here on this spot on your dial. Our cast included Howard Da Silva, Ann Patoniak, Rosemary Rice, and Bob Caliban. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
You have my daughter completely under your spell, Mr. I don't believe we've exchanged names or cards.
Ah, there's no need for formalities here. We're all children of the fates. 'Twas all ordained, eh? Mm-hmm. So, hear my story now. Indulge an older man. What would you guess my years to be then, sir?
Well, it's hard to say. The 50s? Middle, perhaps?
Oh, yeah, yeah. A long, long span of years beyond that. And a long, long span still to go. Yet I've a way of thinking you were led to this door. And that what I have to tell you may affect the rest of your lives.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.